And invite you to open your Bibles to Philippians chapter 4, verses 4 through 7. And as Kaylee reads this, this is our lectionary passage for the day. And we've been following the lectionary through this Advent season. And this year, we are focusing on the coming of Jesus. And so we continue in that vein this morning. And let me invite you to leave your Bibles open to this verse and keep it open in front of you, because we're going to study it together after Kaylee is finished reading.
Rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again, rejoice. Let your gentleness be evident to all. The Lord is near. Do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus.
All right. Thank you, Kaylee. When I was a kid, I used to go to vacation Bible school at a small Methodist church where my grandmother attended. And I don't remember a lot about the Bible school, but I do remember one thing. We used to sing a song, and I won't sing it for you this morning. You would not appreciate that very much. But the words went like this: rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I say rejoice. And we would say that over and over again. Any of you remember singing that as a kid? We would sing, rejoice, rejoice. Again, I say rejoice, and we repeat that over and over again. But what does it mean to rejoice? We don't use that word a lot in our culture today. It's a verb. It is an action. It's something that we do, and you might notice that inside the word rejoice is the word what? Joy, exactly. It means to feel or show joy or delight. Now, whenever we see a word in Scripture that is mentioned more than once, we should pay attention to it. And here Paul says rejoice, and he says it again. He says, I'm going to say it again, rejoice. And he already used the word back in the previous chapter. I'll show you this verse, Philippians 3, verse 1. It says, further, my brothers and sisters, rejoice in the Lord. So three times in just two short chapters is Paul using the word rejoice. He wants us to rejoice in the Lord. And notice he says, when are we to rejoice? Always. In all circumstances. Paul wrote to the church in Thessalonica, rejoice always. Same sort of thing there. Now, maybe when you hear the word joy, you think of Christmas maybe, or you even think of good times. Maybe you're joyful when your team wins a game, or when you get a job promotion, or you do well on that final exam. And you might say, well, it's easy to be joyous in times like this. But Paul says to be joyful when? Always. In times when things are good and in times when things are not so good. Now, you may not know this, but as Paul is penning these words to the church at Philippi, he's sitting in prison. He's awaiting a trial that might result in the death penalty. Now, certainly Paul is not sitting in the lap of luxury telling us to rejoice. He's potentially facing the death penalty, and yet he tells us to rejoice. Now, joy is different from happiness. Do you realize that? You might ask someone, are you happy? And what are you asking? You're asking is, are the circumstances of your life in a good place right now? Are you succeeding, maybe professionally or relationally? Are things going well for you? Are you happy with the way things are for you, you might ask. But joy is something different. Joy is not on the surface. It doesn't come and go with our circumstances like happiness. It's something that's deeper. And so Paul can say, sitting in a prison cell, rejoice. Let me say it again. Rejoice. You might remember in Luke chapter 10 when Jesus sent out his disciples, Jesus knew that it would not be long before he would go to the cross for you and me. He would give his life and then he would ascend into heaven. And the disciples would be the one who would be carrying out the ministry. So Jesus has kind of a boot camp and he sends the disciples out and he gives them power to do miracles. I mean, that'd be pretty cool, wouldn't it? I mean, if you all gather together, by the way, you can heal now. Go on out and do that. So they go out and they come back and they're pumped up. No doubt you would be pumped up too if you had these sort of powers. And look at what Jesus says to them in Luke chapter 10. He says, do not rejoice that the spirits submit to you. Don't get all pumped up because things are going well and you have the power to do these things. But Jesus says, rejoice what? In what? In that your names are written in heaven. One translation says, in the book of life. Jesus tells them, don't rejoice because things are going well. Rejoice because your names are written in the book of heaven. So when Paul says, rejoice in the Lord, he's talking about something different than just happiness. He's talking about something that is rooted in what God has done for us. We are children of God, and that's where we find our joy. Sometimes life is going to be good. Rejoice, Paul says. Sometimes life's going to throw you a curveball. Rejoice, Paul says. Both Jesus and Paul tell us not to put our eggs in the basket of circumstances because that's a fragile place. Circumstances will be good at times and they will be bad at times. But we are called to rejoice in the fact that God has given his all for us, that he's invited us into the family, and that we are children of God. Now, Paul is giving us instructions here, and he continues to instruct, and he says, let your gentleness be known to everyone. Now, you might be reading along here, and he tells us to rejoice, and then he tells us to be gentle. And you might think these two phrases are disconnected, but look at the ESV translation. I like this word better because I think it resembles more of what the Greek is actually saying here. The ESV translates this exact verse, let your reasonableness be known to everyone. The Greek word that's translated as gentle or reasonable there has to do with being fair. It has to do with adhering to the rules. It's often used in the Greek context for a judge who is going to pass a judgment. They would be fair. They'd be reasonable. They'd be measured. They wouldn't fly off the handle. And so that's what Paul is saying here. Be reasonable. And he's looking at the church that's about to undergo persecution, and he says to them, I want you to respond not in anger, not flying off the handle, but in a reasonable, gentle sort of way. Again, the church is going to, again, Paul's sitting in prison. He may experience the death penalty. He doesn't know that. He will eventually, but at this point in time, he's not certain how this thing's going to end. He knows that the church at Philippi is going to experience persecution. He tells them to rejoice, and then he tells them to respond in such a way in which their gentleness is known to everyone. Not flying off the handle, but trusting that God is going to take care of them and that that's all they need to be concerned about. Can you imagine being persecuted and not responding with bitterness or anger? Can you imagine being persecuted and not wanting to enact revenge? This could only happen if our focus is not on the present circumstances, but is on a greater reality. Jesus told his followers, look, don't rejoice in circumstances. Rejoice because your names are written in the book of life. In the same way, Paul instructs the Philippians, rejoice in all circumstances. Not focusing on the persecution that would come, but focusing on their relationship with God. Now, for the past several weeks, we've been talking about the anticipation that the scripture writers have in the return of Christ. The fact that Jesus is going to come back, that Jesus is going to restore the world, that he is going to make all things right. And in our text today, we see this same sort of anticipation here. This is the anticipation that God is calling us to live in. And I have to be honest, I don't always anticipate this in the same sort of way that God is calling us to do it here. And everything that we experience, everything in this life that we see, it should be measured against the joy of the return of Christ. Let's bring this into the context of the Christmas season. Let's just say that you're playing with your child. Maybe you're playing with Star Wars toys or Lego toys or maybe a dollhouse or video games. And you're playing just a few weeks before Christmas and all of a sudden the toy breaks, how do you think the child's going to respond, right? Probably with frustration, anger, maybe even tears. But as an adult, as someone who knows what's going to happen at Christmas, you might say something to your child like this: hey, you know what? Christmas is in just a few weeks, and you're going to get new toys. In fact, you probably won't even care much about this broken toy in a few weeks because Christmas is coming. This is the same sort of thing that Paul is telling the church at Philippi. I want you to focus on what is coming. I want you to focus on the fact that Jesus is in control and he is going to make all things right. I want you to rejoice, not because things are going well for you, but because of something deeper, something inside of you, something that is secure and that no one can ever take away from you. And that is the fact that you are a child of God. And 100 years from now, the life circumstances that we get so worked up about won't even matter. But our names written in the book of life will matter. Jesus is going to return. He's going to make all things right. And it's tough, isn't it, to gain that perspective in the world in which we live? Living in this sort of anticipation, I admit, it's difficult, isn't it? It requires really a shifting of our worldview. And as we keep reading here, we can see that Paul does not just simply say, rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I say rejoice and let's go home, right? He gives us practical instructions on how all this works out. Look at what he says here, and this is great stuff here. Philippians chapter 4, verse 6. Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God. Now, if you suffer from anxiety, if you suffer from worry, if you get worked up about things, this is a verse that you need to print out and put on your refrigerator so you see it every single day. It's a very practical verse, and it's a loaded verse. What is Paul saying here? Paul says to take our anxieties, take the things that we get worked up about, and we are to present them to God. How do we do that? We say, God, I'm worried about this. God, I'm going to take this that I'm anxious about, and I'm going to give it to you. And notice how he tells us to do that. He tells us to do it with thanksgiving, with gratitude. Isn't that interesting? And you see how this works out? When you are thankful for what God has already done, it's easier, isn't it, to give him your anxieties for the things that he has yet to do. Because he's been faithful in the past, he will be faithful in the future, and we can trust him with our stuff in the future. You see, I love that about Advent. Advent, we're living in the in-between, aren't we? We see that he has come through a baby. He lived and gave his life on a cross for you and me. He was faithful to do what he said he would do. And we can celebrate the fact that he will be faithful to return just as he said he will do. We're living in the in-between. We are looking back, and we're grateful, and we're thankful, and we're looking forward. Let me say, if you have trouble giving your anxieties to God, let me challenge you to make a list of all the things that God's ever done for you. And you start writing those down. God's been faithful. He's been faithful. He's been faithful. I'm worried about this. I'm going to give it to him and trust that he will be faithful again. That's exactly what Paul's telling us to do. Present your requests to God with thanksgiving. Take your anxiety and give it to God. And look at what he says will happen here in verse 7. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Another loaded text here. Don't you love that? How many of you would be willing to take your anxiety and trade it in for peace? Anybody? I would. That's a good deal, isn't it? And how does that work out? That we would take our anxieties, we would give it to God, and he would in turn give us peace? What does Paul say? It transcends our understanding. We can't understand how that works out. It doesn't make sense how that works out. It's a mystery how that works out. But the promise is here in Scripture. We take what we're anxious about, we give it to God, and he in turn gives us a peace that transcends all our understanding, and it will guard our hearts and our minds, key words, in Christ Jesus. What a powerful text this morning. A powerful text that we can say, I don't understand how this works out. I don't understand how I can give my anxieties to God. And it's tough to do that sometimes. Let me say, and over and over again we have to do it, because what we give to God one day, we might be anxious about the next day, right? But we give it to Him, and He in turn gives us a peace, and it will guard our hearts, and it will protect us. Now think about what the people that Paul is writing this letter, they're going to have to go through. They're going to have to go through intense persecution. Life will not be good for many of them. Persecution will come. But yet they somehow will have a peace that transcends understanding. They'll somehow take their anxiety. They'll give it to God, and He'll return peace to them, and He'll guard their hearts. What a powerful text, don't you think? We need to understand. Paul is not writing these words from a padded mansion overlooking the Mediterranean Sea. He's writing these words from prison, awaiting trial. He's writing these words to a group of believers who are going to have to have this sort of refocus in their lives. And the challenge for you and me this morning in the season of Advent is to refocus, to gain a different worldview, to rethink how we think about things, to place our anxieties in God's care, and to receive a peace that only He can give. This might seem like a pipe dream. This might seem like something beyond your and my ability, but allow me to challenge you this Advent season to focus on what's coming. Like a child with a broken toy, Christmas is just around the corner. There will be better toys, new toys. And by the grace of God, I can proclaim to you today that Jesus is coming. God has been faithful to His people through all generations, and He will remain faithful for all future generations. God is planning to make the world right. He's planning to return. He's planning to finish what He started all the way back in Genesis. May we learn to live in this reality. May we learn to be a people excited about what God is going to do. And as we live in this anticipation, we'll find that we're able to place our anxieties in His care. And we'll find that we will be able to rejoice in all things at all times. Are you struggling this morning to place your anxieties, your worries at the feet of Jesus? Let me invite you to do that today. The altar is open, and maybe this morning as we stand and sing, you would come and pray, and just at the altar, you would place your anxieties at the feet of Jesus, and you say, God, I want that peace. Maybe this morning, you're struggling with sin in your life. You're struggling with guilt. You can place that at the feet of Jesus. You can trust in the fact that He died on the cross for you. Maybe you'll do that for the first time this morning and receive the grace and the peace that only He can give. How might God be calling you to respond this morning? I'll be standing down front. If there's a decision you'd like to make, if you'd want to pray with me, or if you'd like to simply come on your own and pray, you do that as the band comes and sings. And as the Spirit of God would lead you today, you are invited to respond. Let's stand and sing together.